And now let's go over to Pam Rhodes at Kempton Park, where she's got some beautiful motorcars for us to look at.
We know of some second-hand car dealers who've recently been seen crying real tears into their gin and tonics. There's no money in it, they cry. The bottom's dropped out of the market, they moan. And of course, people like you and I can't really feel very sorry for them, because if it's true, it's got to be good news for us as buyers. But the trades say that the situation is almost as bad in the classic road car market, with cars like the Jaguar XK120, the XK140, Austin Healey 3000, the E-Type Jags all going for a song, and that again must be good news for people who are buying cars in that market. But it's when you leave the road for the track that you find a very different situation. In the world of historic racing cars over the last 3 or 4 years, the prices have gone soaring up and up until they look more like telephone numbers. 4 years ago, a Maserati 250F would sell for £40,000. And today, well, we know of two for sale at £90,000 and £100,000. Or take this Maserati, even more rare than a 250F. This is the 8CTF, built in 1938, and it came third in the 1939 German Grand Prix. 12 years ago, it was sold for £2,000. Last year, its owner refused an offer of £135,000. And the owner in question is Cameron Miller. Cameron, why is it, do you think, that the prices of these old racing cars have rocketed so much in the last few years?
Well, I think there are two reasons. The interest has become enormous throughout the world, not just in this country, but everywhere. And in Britain, we started the interest about 15 years ago. And secondly, I think there are too many people chasing too few of these interesting cars.
They're a dying breed almost, aren't they?
Well, that's it. You will never get another one. Only three of these were made. Many of these lovely cars are in museums, which is interesting from the average public, but it's no good. I mean, the car is meant to be raced. You have a car, you use it. You have a racing car, you race it.
This is a Ford GT40. The race version's won at Le Mans 3 times. And this is actually a road car, but it could, if you really wanted to, be converted into a full-blooded racer. But the point is that even as a road car, this could have been bought 8 years ago for £6,500. And the price today? £65,000. And this is the Lola T70, another elegant classic machine. This one is an out-and-out racer. 10 or 11 years ago, a car like this one would have cost about £6,000, and the price now is £35,000. Well, Adrian Hamilton has bought both these cars from the family garage in Bagshot, Surrey. Well, Adrian, you described this car as a road car, but just how good is it then as a racer?
It would make an excellent race car, as proved by the 3 Le Mans victories that the Fords won with the car. As a road car, it's also very good. This particular one has cigar lighters, puffers and blowers, heaters, very capable. Even you could go shopping in it.
I just wondered, though, with prices in the thousands that we've been quoting, who would buy a car like this?
A collector, an enthusiast, somebody who wants a fine investment, somebody who likes collecting nice objects like paintings, china, stamps, motor cars, why not?
Well, this car isn't a racer, it's really much more venerable than that. Rod Leach of Nostalgia owns and cherishes this lovely Bentley, and if I owned it, Rod, I'd cherish it too. How old is it?
It's 1924.
And how much would it have cost then at that time?
I think the list price was about £875.
Compared with what sort of price now?
Now, around about 30,000.
And we said that this wasn't a racer, but in actual fact, cars like this did race, didn't they?
Oh, Bentleys dominated Le Mans in the 1920s, and cars very similar to this.
Well, considering then that Bentleys were the original sports racers, how have they kept up in comparison with the prices of some of the other cars we've been seeing here today?
I think probably identically. I was looking at some old advertisements the other day and discovered that 3-litre Bentleys in 1964 were about £300. In about 1972, they were £3,000, and now, of course, you've got another 1,000% gone on top of that.
Well, that certainly proves the point that there are some cars, just some cars, mind you, that go on appreciating to such a degree that eventually they're beyond the pockets of ordinary folk like you and me. But just one more rather special example to explain what I mean. It lives at the moment, surrounded, of course, by other Ferraris at Modena Engineering of East Horsley. It's a Ferrari 512S, and I think I could describe its appeal by saying it's a bit like owning your own Leonardo da Vinci, but on wheels. Well, Richard Bond is the director of Modena. Can you tell us a bit about this car?
Well, this car actually was built in 1969 by the Ferrari factory, was raced extensively in 69 and 70. did all the world championship long distance races.
So it's got quite a pedigree, really, hasn't
it?
Who owns it now?
The car currently is owned by Nick Mason, who's the drummer in the Pink Floyd.
And quite well known as a racer, too.
Yes, he is. Yes, he's in the last 4 years or so, he's done quite a lot of racing, current sports cars and old historic cars.
Well, bearing in mind that he probably wouldn't want to part with it, what sort of price do you think he'd ask now if he were selling it?
It's always a terribly difficult question to answer that, but I would estimate it would be between 80 and 90,000.
Well, of course, the place to see historic racing cars in action is in the Lloyds and Scottish Championship, and the current leader is racing driver Jerry Marshall with a very special car, because I gather there are only three of these in the world, Jerry.
That's right, they made three. It's an Aston Martin DBR4 Grand Prix car.
Well, as a racing driver, if you're driving around in 70,000 worth of car, how does that affect your driving? Does it limit you in any way?
No, not really. You don't drive to above yourself to have accidents anyway. And my theory about it is that the car, being so valuable because of its history and its uniqueness, you'd be hard pushed to have an accident that cost more than £5,000 to repair. Whereas you could have a cheaper car and you could have a £5,000 accident and the car's not worth repairing.
Well, let's move over to another car, in fact, that you've driven in. This is a listed Jaguar. Again, what would this have cost, say, 4 years ago?
Well, again, one changed hands for around £7,000 four years ago.
And today?
And the same car is reputed to have made £35,000.
Is there a danger, then, of these cars outpricing themselves, really? I mean, what does that mean for the future of historic car racing?
No, I don't think it does, because they're so different from the other classes of racing that there will always be an interest. There's the pride of ownership, they're great fun to drive, they're a spectacle, and as I said, they're always repairable. What man has made, man can remake.
Mike Bowler, who until recently was editor of Thoroughbred and Classic Cars magazine, actually races a listed Jaguar himself, and he's very aware of these spiralling prices. Mike, is there a danger, do you think, with prices going up in this frightening way, that these cars are going to disappear off the racing grid and just end up in museums?
Fortunately, there isn't. We're all enthusiastic enough about driving the cars to want to keep them going. And obviously, there are more cars than one really needs to fill a grid. So some can go to museums without actually destroying the interest in the historic grids.
What can be done, then, do you think, to preserve historic motor racing?
As long as people who are likely to support these races and sponsor these races realise how much it actually costs us to put them on, and that we get good levels of sponsorship, I'm sure we can carry on quite happily. But the Vintage Sports Car Club, who have always championed old car racing of all sorts, they're quite happy to accept cars built up from the required number of real parts. But as long as we don't get more cars than were actually made appearing on any one grid, we're not defying history too much.
Well, there have been dark rumours that some competitors have been quite happy to trundle around at the back of the field and not really race at all. And in some ways, thinking about the prices and the values that we've heard about today, who can blame them? On the other hand, it would be a great pity, and it would deprive motor racing of some of the most evocative sights and sounds in racing.